In this section, I'll introduce the idea that a chaotic dynamical system, like the logistic equation with R equals 4, is a deterministic source of randomness. In order to do so, we'll have to think carefully about what randomness means. What does it mean when we say a process or an outcome is random? I'll build up a series of arguments layer by layer. None of these arguments are particularly technical in the sense that they don't require calculus or algebra. However, they are conceptually rich and a bit abstract. But I think we'll end up with some really interesting conclusions that will be perhaps surprising and I hope a lot of fun to think about. So let's get started. I'll start by introducing a technique known as symbolic dynamics. The idea behind symbolic dynamics is to convert an orbit, a series of numbers, in this case between 0 and 1, into a sequence of symbols. And the standard way to do this is as follows. If our iterate x is less than 0.5, I'll call that L. And if x is greater than or maybe equal to 0.5, I'll call that R. So I'm picturing this would be in the left half of the unit interval, and this is on the right half. The symbols you use are completely arbitrary. You could use hearts and spades, or X and Y, or zeros and ones, but I'll use L and R. So for example, suppose we had the following itinerary. Okay, so here are the first couple iterates for the logistic equation. Again, R equals 4, and the initial condition is 0.613. So let's convert these into symbolic dynamics. So 0.613, that's greater than a half, that would be an R. 0.949, that's also greater than a half, that would be R. 0.194 is less than a half, less than 0.5, I'll call that L. 0.625, that's greater than a half, that's an R. This is also greater than a half, so that would be an R. So the idea is that I can take any itinerary, any orbit, a sequence of numbers between 0 and 1, and convert that into a sequence of symbols, R, R, L, R, R, in this case. So once we have a symbol sequence, the idea is that we can study the dynamics of the symbol sequence instead of the dynamics of the original orbit. And in many cases, one can show that the properties of the orbit are the same as the properties of the symbol sequence. So studying the symbol sequence is just as good as the original orbit. So let me write that. So properties are the same for the orbit and the symbol sequence. So when I say properties, what I mean is that, say, the existence of fixed points and the stability of fixed points, the symbolical dynamical system involving just the symbols L and R would have the same number of fixed points and their stability would be the same. And if the symbol sequence, the symbolic dynamical system has, say, sensitive dependence on initial conditions or aperiodicity, then the original orbit, the original dynamical system would as well. Now, this isn't an obvious statement at all, because it seems like by going to symbols, I'm throwing out a lot of information. After all, any number that was between 0 and a half, I decided to just turn into L. So that's a very coarse thing to do. There are lots and lots of numbers, an infinite number of numbers between 0 and a half, and I just turned all of those into L. So it seems as if I'm losing information, so how can these two things be the same? Well, it turns out that for this particular way of forming symbols, one can show and argue the following. So let me do this maybe with an example of sorts. Suppose I showed you a symbol sequence, R, R, L, R, L, L, R. Make that look a little bit more like an R. Okay. So then I might ask you, what initial conditions could have given rise to this particular symbol sequence? And one can show, you can kind of infer backwards, that that would correspond to a pretty narrow region of initial conditions. And moreover, that would just be, it would be a single connected region that would give rise to this. Then I could say, well, okay, well, what if the sequence was, say, this? And then you could show that that the possible initial conditions that would have given rise to an orbit whose symbol sequence is this would be smaller still. And if I add another symbol, the possible initial conditions that give rise to this is smaller still. And so in the limit that the symbol sequence becomes infinitely long, the possible initial conditions that would give rise to it become infinitely small. Another way to say this is that if you give me one single initial condition, the symbol sequence that results from that is unique. There's one and only one symbol sequence that that results from that one single initial condition. And that sort of makes sense. This is a deterministic dynamical system. So the key feature here is that there's a one-to-one relationship between initial conditions and symbol sequences. So if you tell me the infinitely long symbol sequence, I could know the I would know the initial condition. And if I know the initial condition of a deterministic dynamical system, that contains all the information about the orbit. So the infinite sequence encodes for the initial condition, and the initial condition, together with a dynamic, tells you the orbit, and from that one can get the properties. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that the information in these symbol sequences is the same as the information in the initial conditions. And ways of forming symbols from numbers that have this property are called generating, and the particular scheme is sometimes called a generating partition. So I don't want to write down a formal definition of this, because I think it'll get us too far afield and get us into some really difficult notation. But a partition, and a partition was just to go back here, this in a sense would be the partition, the description of the symbolic dynamics. This tells me how to go from the orbit, the x's, to the symbols, the L and R. That this scheme would be called a generating partition if longer and longer sequences encode for smaller and smaller and unique non-overlapping regions of initial conditions. Okay, so not all symbolic encoding schemes have this nice property. So in fact, if I had chose 0.4 as the cutoff, so if x was less than 0.4, I call it L, and it's R otherwise, then that would not have this property. So it's only special partitions, special ways of encoding, that have this nice feature. But the one that I described does indeed have this nice feature. So it's only when this is the case that this is true. So let me just, to make things a little more accurate, say, you know, if we use a generating partition. So provided that we have a generating partition, which we do in this case, the properties of the orbit and properties of symbol sequences are, in the sense I've described, the same. Lastly, I want to mention that this technique of symbolic dynamics is a way of proving things about dynamical systems. So I said in the last set of lectures that it's proved rigorously that when R equals 4, the logistic equation has sensitive dependence on initial conditions and the orbits are aperiodic. The way one would go about doing that proof, and this is just a very, very rough sketch, would be to do this mapping from the original dynamical system to symbol sequences, prove properties of these symbol sequences, and then if all of this holds, which it would in this case, what you prove about the symbol sequences, which are easier to work with, turn out to be true about the orbit as well. In any event, now that we have this idea of symbolic dynamics, let's take a look at what symbolic dynamics look like for the logistic equation with R equals 4.